Our brains are amazing, but even at the edge of understanding, there's just so much that's not fully understood. How does forming a new memory change your brain?
Where does personality lie in the brain?
And what distinguishes a genius brain from someone less clever, Aurora? These questions are incredibly important, but phenomenally hard to answer, which is why I'm here. Cambridge University, the MRC Cognition and Brain Sciences Unit, where every day researchers are attempting to answer these exact questions. All within one place, there's an MRI machine, an EEG lab, an MEG lab, eye tracking facilities, and psychophysiology recording facilities.
I also got the chance to sit down with Rick Henton.
Thank you so much for speaking to me today.
He's the deputy director of this place, and I asked him some questions about neuro research here.
So let's see the equipment that lies at the cutting edge of brain research and see how it's being used to understand and improve mental well-being across the lifespan. So my first question is, what's the ultimate goal of this research facility and what are you trying to achieve here?
So the ultimate goal of the MRC CBU is to understand how our brains enable our cognition, our ability to remember things, to speak language, to feel things, and ultimately how that relates to our mental health.
So this place uses three main approaches for studying the brain. MRI, which stands for magnetic resonance imaging and looks like this. MEG, which stands for magnetoencephalogram and looks like this, and EEG, which stands for electroencephalogram and looks like this. How do these work and what do they show?
Hold my beer.
Let's start with MRI. When you enter an MRI, you're entering a really strong magnetic field which temporarily aligns the protons in your body's water molecules. Radio waves are then applied, causing the protons to emit signals. These signals are captured by detectors and a computer converts the signals into images of your brain. MRI machines mainly take structural pictures of your brain or functional images of your brain. Structural images are kind of like single photographs, whereas functional MRI, or fMRI, is like a video camera, able to see how your brain changes across time as it does certain tasks. Next, we have MEG. MEG is another kind of brain scanner that detects tiny changes in magnetic fields produced by our own brain activity. Thinking and moving produces electrical signals which actually cause changing magnetic signals. The MEG detects these changes and then processes them into signals from all the different parts of the brain. By mapping these magnetic fields, scientists can pinpoint which areas of our brain are busy during specific tasks or thoughts. Finally, we have EEG, which looks like this. EEG records the electrical signals produced by our brain. It uses small sensors on your scalp to detect this activity. These signals help scientists and doctors understand brain activity and diagnose conditions like epilepsy or sleep disorders.
And why is it so beneficial to have multiple imaging modalities all in one place? Because I think that's what's really unique about this place is you've got the MRI here and the MEG and EEG. Why is it so beneficial for them to all be in one place?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So each technique has strengths and weaknesses. So MRI, you mentioned, is very good in terms of spatial resolution. So we can tell, we can localize activity in the brain down to about a millimeter. And that's still billions of neurons, but it's still really good spatial resolution. Whereas MEG, the other technique you mentioned, has good temporal resolution. It can measure activity every millisecond. So if we combine the temporal information in MEG or EEG with the spatial information with MRI, we can obtain sort of spatial temporal movies of activity over the brain as someone, for example, reads a word or processes a happy face or whatever the stimulus might be.
This has resulted in influential research, including the working memory model, back when this place was called the Applied Psychology Unit, theory of mind in children with autism, and game-changing research on the neural basis of depression, as well as new and novel approaches to improving mental health.
This paper is actually so interesting about how suppression of thoughts can improve mental health. I might actually do a whole video just on this paper.
I also asked about some of the limitations of this research.
Do you think that current technology does still put a limit on how much we can understand about the brain?
Yeah, definitely. So I mentioned earlier that MRI has a resolution of a millimeter, but that's still billions of neurons. Ultimately, we'd love to record activity in individual neurons in the human brain, and that's very hard to do non-invasively. It is done occasionally in surgery, but generally very hard to do, and so we need to improve our technologies so that in future we have even greater spatial precision.
So here in Cambridge, amongst these beautiful gardens, the researchers here are chiseling away at the current edge of human understanding of the brain, contributing to the slow but unstoppable tidal wave of research around the world to better understand our most complex and mysterious organ. Want to get involved here? I asked about that too.
How can undergrads or other students get involved in the research here?
So we do run a summer placement scheme for undergraduates who want to come and work here over the summer holidays, and you can apply for that. Or an undergraduate can write directly to one of the researchers here if they're particularly interested, and it might be possible to come and visit and get some experience of neuroimaging research. And if you want to participate in our experiments, we're always looking for new volunteers to come and take part in our studies. And it's a good way to learn what neuroimaging is like, to actually experience it as from a participant's point of view.
So for somebody who wants to go into a career or a PhD in neuroimaging, what kind of background is very strong for that? Is it the neuroscience route in university, psychology, computer science?
Yeah, I think neuroscience would be the best option, but very few UK universities offer an undergraduate in neuroscience. So a lot of people have a degree in psychology, and that allows you to understand the cognitive aspects of the task that we give people in a scanner and exactly what we're trying to understand. But other people have degrees in computer science or maths or physics, which is very important for understanding the more technical aspects of neuroimaging, so how to analyse these very complex data.
Thank you so much to the MRC CBU for hosting me. Let me know if you have any questions, and I'll see you in the next one.